starts out looking at each state, a different part of the region. It tells the people each on their part of the region. But, so that's the top grid. In the second period, one of the people has an incentive to cheat and keep moving his card more towards the middle of the region, and getting more and more people to come to his ice cream cart. And then, second seller sees this, and they move slightly towards the middle of the beach. So, like this equilibrium outcome of being under a hotel floor, two people selling the same thing, but a linear population, linear homogenous population, is that both people selling an ice cream would be right next to each other in the middle of the beach. So they would be maximizing the people to one side of them. They would be maximizing the service to subscriber by, they would be maximizing their captive market. So, it's also what we call the linear city model. They're going to put both gas stations next to each other in the middle of the city, and they're captive from each direction. That's one of the ones applications. Some people have talked about it as a model for two political party system, where they're just fighting on the median voter. So the median position is on the Republican and Democratic Party, the beach would be right in the middle, and they're just fighting on the 51st% voter that people identify with any hotel results, that's just a cute one. Back here, we're going to talk about the hotel rule. The hotel rule is for hotels for resource. The punchline to start with is that the price goes up at the rate of interest. There's a price path. The price is going up over time at the rate of interest. Okay, we're putting out things to start with that price path. Price is going to go up at the rate of interest. The price at time zero is going to equal the discounted price at the future time on interest rate. And the question is, why is it equal? So if the price now is greater than the discounted price, if the price for owning the resource now is higher than it's going to be worth 10 times greater in the future, well, then we should sell and invest the money elsewhere at the rate of interest R. Because we'll be better off. Our money will grow faster if we sell the resource and invest it at R. If our price at time zero is less than it's going to be discounted in the future, we should wait because it's going to be worth more in the future. Price is going to go up. The price of the resource is going to go faster than the interest rate. So the price rises. At equilibrium, the price is going to rise at the rate of interest. This is just a way to turn around. Next year's price is going to be the base year's price going up at the rate of interest. Two different ways to think about the same thing. Another way to think about this for Gofian intuition is this question of when to buy resource. When would it be worth buying this resource? You want to figure out the value on some sample growth records. Is this value worth it? You want to buy oil futures. Don't turn out it's way too complicated, but the general question of can you tell whether to bid for oil futures or for oil leases. So at the price going up at the rate of interest, is there going to be a market clearing price where you're indifferent between having it at the two time periods? If the current price is greater than the future discount price, people could sell. If the current price is less than the future discount price, it's a good investment. It's going to outperform other people there. Increasing R, so people want to buy it. So the prices are going to adjust, the equilibrium prices are going to adjust to the point where this is equal to operating at a lesson. So the surplus is going to shorten, the prices are going to adjust to their time path, make something that people are indifferent to not holding it versus other investments. It's not meeting other investments, but underperforming the other investments. All right, so I'm going to motivate this super easy graphical book, and I'm going to try to do it one by one. It's a graph that links four different graphs. So four quadrants, so I'm going to go through quadrants one by one. First is the demand curve. So we just think about what's the units on our different curves, okay? Our demand curve is price and volume. Our discounting curve, so this is the hotel and price graph curve, is time and price. And the punchline and the policy curve that we're trying to get to talk about how to manage natural resource, how to manage an exhaustible resource, how much rent, full growth rate to sell each time period, textbook, or how much hover, to pull out our hover line, is this harvest map and extraction map. Quantity per time, quantity per year. So this is sort of like what the hoteling model is going to tell us about the path to be pulling out of our mind. We don't have a tourist in mind. So we have a price path. We have a starting price and an interest rate. If whatever year we are into the future, we can figure out what the price is going to be into the future. Price is rising with the interest rate. Given the starting price and interest rate, we can find the price at any time. So, and we have a linear demand curve. So we've already had the demand curve one, the last one. We also want access to quantity on other axes. So we're here in the hoteling, and here, there's this idea that there's a total stock, a resource owner, how much copper ore is in the market. And the total stock is going to be the sum of the amount harvested in each time period. Here's total stock, it's denoted by X, and the quantity harvested in each time period. So, if we know these quantities are going to be related to the prices in each time period. The quantity in T0 is going to be the demand of the price T0. Going forward, P1, P2, T0. We'll get into it, but sometimes we talk about whether it's a fixed number or a capital T, we know that we're going to go 40 periods in the future, we're going to be infinite, we're going to be smaller and smaller. That would be some question on the back something else, but here we're just going to say we have a number of time periods that we're going to use so far so. But the demand, so we go, but this price has been the last line there. We know that all these prices can be brought back to the variables of the interest rate, the starting price, and the time period. But all these different prices and time periods, we have a hotel equation that's telling us they're all linked. They're just the variables of starting price, interest rate, and time period. So we have an equation over time. The stock is the sum of the demand in each of the time periods. The demand is a function of the starting price and the rate we're discounting over time. So, if we use this equation we came up, we can figure out the price and quantity for other time periods. We can know what total amount of stock is, we know how much more is in our mind, we can know our starting price is either the top of the time period, we might know how much more they're going to have to feed in 40 years. So, if we have these variables, we can figure out how to extract over time. So, we're going to have a graph on extraction. The y-dimensional axis, telling you on the other time is not rehearsing a lot. As we get closer to our finals, I've been rehearsing less and less. I mean, you yourself are still rehearsing less and less. That's one before, they're pretending rehearsing a lot here. They're rehearsing less and less over something. You took our stock. At the end, the price is really high, right? It's selling well, they own something very well. We started on something that we're going to sell a lot of the cheap. We changed the axis, we're selling a lot, now we're selling less and less. So, importantly, we can make one is the total volume of harvest. Out of these rates here, all of this graph will be harvested per year, harvested per time period, take per harvest per year. So if we take harvest per year, harvest per time period times time period, or harvest per year times time period, we're going to get a volume. And we can think about these volumes as how much of our harvest we sell each year. We're going to sell so many million barrels of oil out of our oil reserves per year. Each year that we sell is going to create a volume that is sold. We're going to use up our stock. So our stock, let's think about our stock as this whole unit. The margin per time, how much of our stock are we going to sell in each year in each time period? To sell out the whole stock. And we're going to optimize this price out. How are we going to allocate the total stock between the different years? Okay, the fourth graph doesn't have anything at all in common, it's just something that has less value than one to do. So we have three other graphs. We have one graph with a 45 degree angle, and it's going to translate one into ones. So everything will end. Okay, here is the hotelium and floor ones. The upper left corner, we have the price graph. That was prices and time. Prices are going to go up over time with rate of interest. We know, given an initial price and a time and a rate of interest, the characteristics of this graph. It's going to go price for our resource, it's going to go up at rate of interest. But you have the demand curve for the resource. And as the price is going up over time, it's going to reflect different prices onto our demand curve. Our demand curve, on the first lecture, is simple. We're at different prices. It's going to give us different lines. So as the price goes up over time, we're going to start low on the demand curve, selling a whole lot. And then over time, the price is going to get higher and higher and higher. Less and less is going to get sold. These quantities, this is just the thing that reflects quantity to quantity. And these quantities are going to be over here in this harvest map. We have time and quantity. This is the resource management question down here. How much to harvest in each year? Price graph and demand curve, they're telling us how much we're harvesting each year. Allocating the stock of our resource over time. So, start on the left, we have a time period that we're in. We're going to have a price in that time period. It's going to give us the price of that time period. It's going to have a quantity that's going to be demanded at that time period. We come back to this reflector and stay with the same quantity. And that quantity harvested for a year in that year. This demand curve was something that looked at in a stat. That was the beginning of the year. That was before we learned dynamics or any demand curve. When we learned dynamics, we had a path for price over time. We have a price that corresponds to each time here. The demand curve, a price that corresponds to each quantity. So we're trying to get to a quantity that corresponds to each time here. So pretty helpful now to step through the steps in the textbook, which are double both, which is kind of problematic, as I said, because it's not like top line, but we're going to follow along with the textbook. Old both, it's just a thing that I've used up down my time. So we're at the tail end of it, everything's in the second. Is everybody's last name sealed for the record? Everybody? Go, if you had it, you better know what it's like. It's a lot of jobs in California. This was a water company. It was a really big story when I was sitting there, sitting underground. People were protesting about it. People were out there. There was the last remaining rows of old growth. And there was a story about the water company. Why can't I say it? But the white house, they were sort of like a family run local business. I got bought by a venture capital firm. What's called leverage buyout. So they had a whole huge amount of debt. So they came in from that state and jumped on, came from Texas State and Mass State, a whole bunch of debt. They started to double and triple the rate of their money for the old growth that they owned private. So people were fighting against a bunch of state jobs. It was a big issue at the time. That's sort of covered in this chapter. It's well there in the chapter. But Old Growth Redwood's a beautiful thing. Well, you see all around, it's a beautiful house. It's working out of it. One thing is, it's a small growth. It used to just be, you know, the way the price used to be run almost nothing. And there's a big old rate states. And it's taken on states that used to grow the vines on. And it's like a low, it's sort of a low standard. But it's just overgrown. And now Old Growth Redwood's about simply a thing that they used to be using for, you know, single siding method. And now Old Growth Redwood's seeing the limit. So the authors made reference to this work. It's by Peter Berg himself. And he got the price for the Redwood. And he made a regression for the line. Showing that this is really following this hotel price cap. So here's the years 53 to 83, a 30-year time horizon. And if you use the interest rate of 13%, and a starting price of $14, you can get this hotel model to follow. But it actually had a thing like that. They got the price to fall, showed that it was following this hotel price cap. So why it's really nice to use this? And it's not. If, for example, they got an example of something that nearby resources don't know about. What's the secret reason? When we're out here, we're only talking about old growth that we're selling right now, because this is what was there. When we get to this part, when we're running out of it, we realize that there's only a certain amount of old growth industries that are 1,000 years old. Once you get to the scarcity, we start calling old growth, and we know that there's just tiny little patches on that. So, then they have demand curve for Redwoods. One thing we can motivate here is, it starts, you know, they just make a linear demand curve. So, the rest of the book is, you know, this is a simple linear demand curve, but then we have this $650, which is our show price. At $650, nobody's going to buy Redwood. The units here, I'm sorry, I'm going to support 1,000 board feet. So, that's a common measure of number. And we're talking about, so, you know, when you think about show price, it has like about a certain price, and we'll use something else. There'll be another wood that'll be of, you know, like a work, maybe I got some other kind of wood. Now, we have engineered plastics that people are making, single plastic that's tricks. showed us a couple different price tile. And I'm making them to me. So we had a couple of prices here in 1961. The price was $38 for 1,000 more feet. At $38 for 1,000 more feet, 1.39 million feet of redwood were purchased. But in 1980, there's a lot less old growth redwood. We're getting to the point where it's going to be steep there. It's $400 for 1,000 more feet. And $400, 0.57 million more feet are consumed. So here's an enhanced price graph. It's showing us the regression that works. So we can believe them. Price is going really steep towards the end here. And people are at these higher prices consuming less old growth redwood. So we can fit this up to the full four panels. And we can look, this is the extraction map for redwood. We have the price map of barrels from the 1961, from the roads of 1961. The price of the price map was $38 per 1,000 more feet. 1.39 million more feet were consumed. So we're just sitting around at 1.39 per harvested. So what we're doing is getting these two to combine to make this resource extraction happen. This is the total stock area in here. And we're using up our redwood. And we're getting here to the point the price is high, and we're selling around less and less to sell, we're using it. We're getting to the point, if you look on the map, where the market receives it. So here we have our harvest pathway. We have the total impact of this resource that we started with, that's 34.6 billion more feet. We have this extraction pathway that we can get from the resource price increasing and the demand curve of redwood. So in 1933, the first year, there was only 1.4 billion, and 1996, less and less, it's going up towards zero. Can you buy old redwood today? It's very rare. There's something that's challenged. You know, someone's not buying from a lumber company. Another thing that happens is people tear down old barns and mill lumber. So there's things that are made with old red lumber that are out there. And you know, take out old barn mill and sell it. People buy their houses with something that they had to lock 100 years ago. There's recycling old red. But actual timber harvest old red is really good. Okay, so here's our idea that we had full stock. We used it up over time. The price went up, you know, but we were selling it now. There's another example. A couple of examples of a lot more. And that's a little bit of change. And here the question is, what if the interest rate was 20% instead of 10%? So if the interest rate is starting on the left, if the interest rate is 20% instead of 10%, the price that's going up with the interest rate is going to go up a lot faster and a lot steeper. So the dotted line is this new interest rate of 20%. Prices are going up much faster. So here we are in 1970, prices are going up, and it used to be about 100 something, now they're 300, 1,000 more feet. So in 1970, now we're harvesting, we're demanding at this higher price of 314 years, but we're harvesting 76 million more feet per being sold. So we're selling it and consuming it a lot faster. And this model like this, you know, takes a little predicting. They sell out of redwood in the mid-70s. Let's say 20%, they harvested it faster, they moved on extraction, they depleted the resource faster. So this is an example of the different things you can change. You can change the starting price, you can change the interest rate, you can change different things, and see how they would change your extraction pathway. So part of the answer to the 84%, do we have other values than just old growth lumber? Old growth, forest, not lumber. All things are good lumber. But do we have other values? I don't know if you guys heard this story. There's a woman, Julia Hill, and she lived in a redwood tree that was 1,500 years old. 180 feet tall, so it's under collapse, been there for 2 years, 1997 to 1999. This is what's called the Headwaters Forest, it's talked about in the book, Going by the Pacific Lumber. And basically, this lady, it was called the Ideal Federal Estate, by the money and went by some of the last rows of old growth. We all tell you that's a little damage over that. So as a society, we think, let's save this last little bit,